Okay, thank you. Welcome, everybody. It's a wonderful day to be available to serve. I'm excited about what God's going to do today. I'm excited about what He's already done this morning in worship. And isn't it really cool that we get to transmit our worship all around the world? You know, wow. Sometimes I just sit at home and watch the worship videos. Man, it don't get no gooder than that. Oh, I love my church family. Inside your bulletins, you will find a Who is Welcome pamphlet. Take that with you and give it to someone. Okay. And also, if you want to receive at the end of the year a tax receipt, make sure you put your name on this and put it in the envelope. And also, prayer requests, very important, okay? Put them on here. If you want your name in the registry of our church, fill out the other side. Okay. Today is an important day for me because we're setting the stage for Christmas. I celebrate it every day of the year, and I'm sure most of you do too, because where would we be without Jesus? You know? And most of the world is headed to hell. Most of the world. And God has given us a mission to reach the lost, right? It's the Great Commission. It's been given to every Christian. But guys, I got to tell you, I love Scripture. There's no mistakes in it. It's all true, and it's all for us. And so, as we're preparing for Christmas, I want to tell you guys, if you're not willing to live out the Scriptures, then Christmas really doesn't mean much. Because it's not a book of suggestions. It's God speaking to us in His Word. How stunning is that, that we get to read the message that God has given to us anytime we want. We can hear from God anytime we want. I mean, how cool is that, right? And so I chose the book of Jude today to kind of set the stage for our mindset approaching Christmas. Okay. And so the book of Jude is a little long for one setting, and it's a little short for two. So we're going to pack it in today, you know. So I'll stop when I hear your stomachs growling. Relax. All right. Okay. Jude, contending for the faith. You know what contending is? You know, in boxing, the number one ranked contender, he fights for the crown, right? And so contending means that we need to be actively fighting for our Savior. It's a thing that we do every day. That's why this week has been an awesome week for me for outdoing outreach. I always keep the Who is Welcome bulletins in my vest. And so when anybody wants to talk to me, we went to, Michael took us to the Mexican restaurant up here on Friendship and Spout Springs. And there was a group of four people, two married couples. And they asked me, what is set free? And so I I began to tell them, my family's sitting in the booth waiting for me to get there, but I got business, right? I'm about my Father's business, right? And so I stood there for quite a little while telling them about our church, what we're about, you know, and then we went up to get some printing done at Office Max or whatever that thing is up there. And this lady said, because she hadn't seen me, what have you been set free from? What an in, right? I said, and so I showed her my chains that are broken. I said, the chains that had me in bondage to sin have been broken. And so I've been set free, you know. And so this lady was so impressed that I gave her a bulletin. I mean, you know, who's welcome thing. And she loved it. She loved it. So that makes an impact on people. Guys, use these tools. And we got a stack of them back there. Take some with you and give them out. You know, give them out. These vests are very important to break the ice. They're ice breakers. And so use them for that. So Jude is a book that's directed to Christians, directed to brothers and sisters. And so inside your bulletin, Jude 1. Jude, now another name is Judas, but it's not the one that betrayed Jesus. A servant of Jesus Christ. Now he is making this statement. How cool is that? Do we make that statement? I like to hope that we do, you know, so people know what we're about. And the brother of James, son of Alphaeus, to those who have been called, that's us. Okay, that is us. You know that the Bible is good now as it was then? So this Jude is written for us who are loved. Isn't that cool? Even with our shortcomings, with the things that go through our minds that shouldn't, we are still loved by God because of the Lord Jesus. Because without him, we're rotten. Right? Loved by God the Father and kept by Jesus Christ. You know, we can stop right there and eat. You know, that's the whole thing right there. Don't you know who you are? You're God's child. And because of that, the world is going to come against you, man. They are. Mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Sometimes we don't feel like that we have this in abundance, but consider this. You were once going to hell and now you're not. So I'm telling you what, man, it's an abundance poured down on me and you, right? Dear friends, though I was very eager to write to you about the salvation we share. Now, you know what? God can change things. Sometimes when I would come up here having something all laid out to share, and then the Holy Spirit changes it. It's just burning on me. You know, Chris, you know all about that. Gerald. I felt I had to write and urge you to contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to the saints. That's us. It's our job to fulfill the Great Commission, which is contending for the faith. It's God's desire that none perish, but that all come to repentance. And yet most of the world is not going to. For certain men, isn't it neat that Jude is telling us about the problems that lay ahead? Certain men whose condemnation was written about long ago have secretly slipped in among you. you know, in what some most people call the body of Christ, I tell you, there's some charlatans out there. If you know the scriptures, you will not be fooled. If you know the truth, then when a lie comes, you'll identify it right off the bat. You know? They are godless men who changed the grace of our God into a license for immorality. There's a lot of people, I've heard a pastor say, I can live like I want because I'm saved by grace. I tell you, the Holy Spirit is not telling him to say that. I even tell people that you need to back up and readdress the salvation issue. Because if that's how you feel, you're not representing the Jesus that I serve. We are supposed to be examples to the world of the change that we have because of him. And deny Jesus Christ, our only Savior and Lord. In other words, I can do this on my own. I tell you, you'd be surprised how many people think that. And it's really hard here in the Bible Belt because everybody thinks they're saved because they live in the Bible Belt and because they've been going to church. You know? It's a lot easier on the West Coast because people there don't give a rip. They're not claiming to be Christians. They're just living like hell. So it's a lot easier to start from that point than it is to tell, convince somebody that you're not really saved. And this is why. And didn't say it was going to be easy, guys. But that's our mission. Though you already know, Christian, you already know the truth. You already know all this. I want to remind you that the Lord delivered his people out of Egypt. He's pointing out what God has done in the past. You know that, to me, that's really amazing. God says, I heard the cries of my people in Egypt. I've come down to rescue them. After 400 years, some people think that they're going to, right now, God is going to deliver them for what they're going through. 400 years of suffering and slavery. And then God came and rescued them. See, God had all kinds of stuff going on the sidelines to prepare for the rescue, just like our church. 10 years I prayed for Chris. God had other things going on. He was preparing Chris. He was preparing me for this thing to come together. What an amazing thing that was. I want to remind you that the Lord delivered his people out of Egypt, but later destroyed those who did not believe. The naysayers. Guys, I don't want anybody to go to hell. I don't. I don't want to miss any opportunities to share with someone what God has done in my life. Yeah. And the angels, there's a third of them in heaven. This is something that I just cannot understand. A third of the angels in heaven who did not keep their positions of authority but abandoned their own home. These he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. That's going to be a good day for us. You know. Verse 7 is talking about unrepentant people. You know, without repentance, there's no forgiveness of sin. So you can't be saved without repentance. Verse 7, in a similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality. It didn't say they slipped up now and then. That was their whole life. And perversion. They serve as an example of those who suffer the punishment of eternal fire. Unrepentant. We all sin. But the thing is, with Christians, we get right instantly by just repenting. How cool is that? I mean, we don't have to go out and do stuff and earn stuff just to get right with God. It's a simple prayer. You know? In the same way, verse 8, these dreamers pollute their own bodies, reject authority, and slander celestial beings. I remember before I got saved, you talk about polluting my body. I put things in my body that God did not design for it to go in there. You know? So I understand this. But even the archangel Michael, when he was disputing with the devil about the body of Moses, did not dare to bring a slanderous accusation against him. Satan's powerful, guys. We need to hide under the umbrella of Jesus and stay there wherever we go. But said, the Lord rebuke you. I've told some of you guys that when I first got saved, I was so wound up, man. I wanted to go out. I wanted to have a face-to-face confrontation with Satan himself. Because I knew the power that's in me is greater than the power that's in the world. How dumb? How dumb? He's powerful. Yet these men speak abusively against whatever they do not understand. And what things they do understand by instinct, like unreasoning animals, these are the very things that destroy them. I'm so thankful for the book of Jude. Because when you look at our condition of the world today, it's all in here. I was talking this morning, God is not shocked by the perversion of the world and the perversion that has taken over America. God's not shocked. Our mission is the same. No matter how bad it appears around us, our mission is the same. To fulfill the Great Commission. It's God gave us our marching orders, and it's so clear, and yet most people want to distort them. Sad. Says here about these people, says, woe to them. They have taken the way of Cain, of envy. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error, idolatry, adultery. They have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion, opposing the ministers of Christ, standing in opposition to the followers of Jesus. That, my friends, is a dangerous place to be, to come against God's elect. See, we would never really think about these things on our own if God hadn't written this for us. It should be no surprise to you how bad our country has become because they voted God out. I watched it. Guys, God is still in control. Verse 12, these men are blemishes at your love feasts, eating with you without the slightest qualm. They slip in. Shepherds who feed only themselves. What kind of shepherd is that, right? They are clouds without rain, worthless, blown strong by the wind, autumn trees without fruit and uprooted, twice dead, body and soul, twice dead. They are wild waves of the sea foaming up in their shame, wandering stars for whom blackest darkness has been reserved forever, punishment. Guys, we are so fortunate that we don't have to endure any of that because of what Jesus did, not because of what we do. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men. Isn't that cool? See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones. What a prophecy, huh? I can't wait for that. You know, I mean, I may only have 50 years left to live. I don't know, but I hope it happens within that time. To judge everyone and to convict all the ungodly. Guess what we are not? We are not the ungodly because of Jesus, not because of ourselves, right? So you need to get that in your mind. You know that you are loved by God because of what his son did, not because of what you do. Convict all the ungodly for all the ungodly acts they have done in the ungodly way, and of all the harsh words ungodly sinners have spoken against him. That's not us. It's people that have a lifestyle of this behavior. Don't let this get you down. You need to rejoice because of what Jude is writing to us. These men are grumblers and fault finders. Boy, you see those all around, don't you? They follow their own evil desires. They boast about themselves and flatter others for their own advantage. We were talking this morning about how we come into God's living room just as we are. We can't impress God by wearing shark skin suits. He's not impressed by that. He knows how we are all the time. I'm glad about that. I can't afford shark skin suits. I wouldn't wear it if I had one. It ain't me. I'm just Kenny. We need to know where we are in the body of Christ. We are servants of him. Verse 17, but Christians, dear friends, remember that the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ foretold. They said to you and to us, in the last times there will be scoffers. Woo! They are running rampant right now, who will follow their own ungodly desires, mockers. These are the men who divide you, who follow mere natural instincts and do not have the Spirit. They are unsaved. So if they don't have this, because everybody gets the Spirit of God at the time of conversion. And if here it says they don't have the Spirit, that means they're not saved. Don't expect lost people to act like Christians. Don't expect them to do the right thing. It's not in them. It's not. But you, dear friends, Christians, woohoo! Build yourselves up in your most holy faith and pray in the Holy Spirit. You know that's the only way we can pray? Because without the Holy Spirit, we can't talk. We pray in Jesus' name. That's the only way we can reach the Father. Keep yourselves in God's love. This means that we can do it. He's given us our instructions. Keep yourselves in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you eternal life. Oh, I can't wait. The whole purpose of us staying here on earth after we get saved is to reach those who are not saved and prepare ourselves to go to heaven. You know, I'm looking forward to that day. Be merciful to those who doubt. Speak the truth in love, guys. Snatch others from the fire and save them by your testimony. To others show mercy mixed with fear, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh. We gotta love folks, guys. We have to love the unlovable. Because most of us in this room were the unlovable at one time. Jude would say that I'm still unlovable. So let's wrap it up now. To him, talking about Jesus, who is able to keep you from falling, he's the only one, and to present you before his glorious presence without fault. He is doing this. We can't approach him without fault because we have faults. But because of what he did, without fault and with great joy. The joy of the Lord's our strength. Don't walk around like you've been baptized in lemon juice. I call it mud sharking. You know what a mud shark looks like? Don't look like that. People need to see that there's something different about you and that you're happy. Wherever I go, I want to make people smile. Wow. Why? Because God's given me that desire. To the only God, our Savior, the only God. There is no other God. There's others that claim to be gods, but they're not. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we always got to get back to that. We're nothing without him. Before all ages, now and forevermore. Everyone lives forever. The question is where? If we keep that in mind when we're out there, I look at everybody as pre-Christians who's not a Christian. Because if God can save me, then he can save anybody. You know what I mean? And a lot of you maybe have the same testimony. Pre-Christians. I want to do my part so that God will move. In, you know, no one comes to the Father but that the Father draws them. You can't talk somebody and get saved. God has already had to do work there. But what a great opportunity for us to be able to share with somebody who has questions. You know, we got the answer. We do. Amen. Father, thank you for today. Lord, I pray that you'd bless our offering, Lord, that it would meet our needs once again like you always do. And Father, we pray that you would bless the food that we're about to receive, Lord. And it would give us health and strength so we can go out and do what you have commanded us to do. Now, Father, give us sweet fellowship today. As we sit down at tables and talk about you, talk about our lives, Lord, may we have sweet fellowship. Cause us to love each other even more. Send your koinonia love, a love that only comes from you to us, and that we may love each other even when we seem like we're unlovable, because Jesus loves us. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.